I'm Doug Rugh, and today I'm going to do a two-session portrait sketch from the live model. But first, let me tell you a little bit about what we do. The gallery is in a historic shopping area near the Village Green in Falmouth. The space looks like a gallery, but it's really our working studio. We take turns at the easel, and because we are an artist-run gallery, we end up doing a lot of commissions. It could be enlarging a plein air painting into a mantelpiece, or a portrait done from life or photographs. But we return to still life paintings every winter to keep our eye honed. The large studio landscapes are often done entirely from the imagination, or loosely based on field sketches. We never use photos for them unless they are specific commissions. We have a range of styles we work in, from small, detailed, classical still life paintings to large, loose, impressionistic landscapes. We have been full-time oil painters since 2000, and together we are fortunate to have had over 50 years in the visual arts. We're on Cape Cod, so we enjoy a lot of time painting in the landscape. I started doing figure sketches when I was a teenager, and for many years I met twice a week with a group of artists to work from a live model. I still paint for models each week. I would estimate that I've had over 2,000 sessions with a model. I believe it's very important for artists, especially students, to work from life, from a three-dimensional world, and learn to translate all that information onto a flat canvas. Copying photographs teaches you how to match colors, but it doesn't develop your eye as an artist. Real life is much more complex and beautiful than a simple snapshot. Besides, painting from the world as it reveals itself in front of us is a lot more fun. I hope that you will get something new to think about from watching this video. Since every color on a white palette looks dark, even light colors, I've toned my palette mid-gray because I want to judge my colors against a more neutral tone. After years of squinting to see value, tonal values are pretty easy for me to gauge, so I arrange my colors by hue, which is the temperature around the rainbow, and offer the most saturated, pure colors available. I include earth tones, which are lower in tinting strength, as body filler. I use various brands of paint. If I'm doing a large painting with a lot of texture, say a landscape, I might want to use a more fluid paint, like the kind that typically comes in large tubes that I can apply quickly with a loaded brush. If I'm doing a small detailed still life on a panel, I prefer a stiffer, handmade, fully pigmented paint with which I can control the modeling of small details. For many of my classical still lifes, I often hand mold the pigment into the oil so I can control the quality of the paint. I've experimented with various old mediums, but now I rarely use more than just a tad bit of linseed oil as a medium, and mostly just use paint straight out of the tube. Solvents are toxic. I just use a little bit of linseed oil to clean out my brushes as I'm going. I like to start out with the biggest bristle brush that I can control and try to cover the canvas with paint. I can't really start painting until I've got a paint layer to work with, and a stiff brush is needed to apply that first layer. Once I've got a wet surface to work with, the longer brushes, with their flexibility, are great for moving paint around, and the old short stubby ones are used for scrubbing on the thinnest glazes. I even save some of the splayed brushes by cutting around the edge of the ferrule. These long badger hair brushes are responsive to the touch. They can make a long stroke or soft enough to apply color that blends or sits on top of underlayers based on touch, and can make very expressive strokes. These are great for sculpting details and softening edges. Fine sables have shorter hairs and can be used to accurately place tiny details and thin layers when the rendering is important. I like a watercolor squirrel mop for blending large areas. They're soft and have a non-distinct edge. I even wash these just with hand soap to keep them on the dry side. I use a mall stick to steady my hand when painting details, and everybody asks about the stick. I have a bunch of them that I've made at various lengths. I like to use a wooden egg from a hobby shop because the egg fits so perfectly in my hand. On the other end, I glue a small ball so that it doesn't accidentally scrape the canvas. Today, my wife Hillary is going to pose for a live session. I asked the model to point their nose at something on the wall. It's okay if their mouth and eyes move, and their hair and clothing will most likely rearrange themselves next time they sit down. Make sure they are comfortable and enjoying the process. Try to get good posture, and if they cross their arms or legs, those parts may fall asleep. I'll choose a warm spotlight for this demonstration. It's an easier light to work with because shadow edges are stronger. A raking light, which puts half the face in shadow, will emphasize form at all the shadow edges. A more flattering light comes from the front and washes out those features that emphasize age. It's interesting to try painting in different lights. Natural daylight is beautiful to work with, but formal nuances demand careful modeling. The daylight balanced box light has such a wide beam that it softens shadow edges and makes for a flattering, cool light. Today I'll just bounce that light on the ceiling over my workspace to help me see my canvas in a consistent light as that outdoor light changes in and out. Today I'm going to work in on a two-session painting. I have found that a comfortable pace for a model is timed 20-minute sessions with 5-minute breaks. Keep in mind, in this video, my hand is working at a quicker pace because I've condensed the footage of a 3.5-hour session into the shorter video. I start with very light lines and a synthetic brush that has a sharp edge. The lines only need to be barely visible, and each time I correct a line, it gets a little darker. I'm trying to visualize the head on the rectangle. I try to use straight lines and corners, and as I work around the canvas and place a corner, I continuously check its relationship with other points throughout the head. Corners can be turned into round forms later with a sweep of a brush, but curves are hard to measure against. It's a peripheral way of working where you're keeping the wide view and placing anatomy points in relation to each other. It's sort of like drawing the spots of a constellation. You place the marks and then judge the angles and distances between them. Until the last dab of paint touches the canvas, we have to keep in our mind that everything should always remain flexible and that we should continue to improve on this underlying drawing. All of this is going to be obliterated anyway. We'll be revising until the last dab of paint. Look for the eyes to be halfway up the height of the head. Beginners underestimate the top of the head. Start with measuring the distance between nose, mouth, and chin in thirds. Leave room for a head on each shoulder. Hillary has a long neck, but usually the shoulders cross behind the face. The hair and scarf will change, so I just get a sense of the weight that they will occupy on the canvas and try not to define them too definitely. Since I'm using a front-on lighting, I'm relying on precisely placed small shadow areas to define features. I look for shadows on planes that face downwards, away from the light. Whenever I make a mark, I think about how muscles bulge outwards. Even if the shadow on the neck looked like a straight line, I would look for a way to curve my line to describe the round cylinder that the shadow crosses. The curving back angle and variation in the lower part of the hair is an interesting design element that I will play off against the quick downward lines of the scarf. It's a long sweep that ends in short, quick edges and that creates a nice rhythm. We can't judge color until we compare it to surrounding colors. As I had on my palette, I like a mid-tone on my canvas so that right away I can compare lights against darks. I really won't know whether this color I'm applying is right or not until I've got the whole head covered with paint. First, I like to establish my darkest darks and my lightest lights, and then fill the value range in between. I look for general warm and cool darks and warm and cool lights and use as big a brush as possible. A hog bristle, say, with paint out of the tube to build up these initial layers. When we look at a lit form, light particles sit on top of the darks. Because of this, it helps to paint dark areas first and then physically apply the light on top. The thing to watch out for is that when you're painting your lightest lights, that they don't blend together with an under layer, which is still wet, and end up being a darker color than intended. Soft brushes and a soft hand keep these strokes on top. Remember also that the more times you stroke a spot, the more it blends with the underneath area. As I block in the scarf, I'm trying to establish my highest saturated color in the blue that is hit by light. The most saturated colors come straight out of the tube, and they're the purest. Anytime you mix any colors together, they start to get grayer, so I keep this color and my brush as clean as possible. If I was doing a classical rendering of this scarf, another option would be to paint the lights of the scarf in white, and then glaze over that with pure color to create an even more luminous effect. I'm really trying to stretch the pigment here, because it is such a pure color. I also like to use a bigger brush, which will give me bigger strokes, because this will make the skin, in contrast, look soft next to the clothing. As I block in the flesh tones, I look for warms and cools, and for areas of local color. The local color in one's cheek and nose tends to be pinker. The forehead, which can be shaded by the hair, is usually paler because it receives less sunlight, and it's often shinier because it is tighter to the bone. I look for hues of the scarf and vest to be reflected in parts of the face which angle downward. I try to emphasize the cylinder shape as I shade the neck. I blocked in the warm orange lights. Since I'm going for a color at the other side of the color wheel, I'll clean my brush out well or get another brush before I work with the cool daylight. If residue is in my brush, it will make my color gray. The likeness depends on many tiny fractions of an inch lining up perfectly. A 1/16 of an inch off in several places can turn a pleasing expression into a scowl or age a fresh countenance. As I paint the fine edge of this cool light, I need my mahl stick to steady my hand. Now back to establishing my lightest lights on the warm side of the head. Highlights take the shape of the light source. The cool light from the wide windows is diffuse, but this hot spot light will make sharp round highlights, and the shape of those ovals define the forms that they lay upon. Midtones wrap around forms contrary to the direction of the muscles, but highlights often traverse the length of those forms. These lights are brightest when they face the light source, and their sharpness also expresses how shiny the skin is, how wet it looks. When working on portraits, keep in mind that some parts of your subject are going to move more than others. In a two-session portrait, I'm never fully committed to the clothing or the hair until the end of the second session. It's going to change anyway, and unless it looks especially interesting in the first session, I just won't finish it off. I need to establish the color to compare relationships, but I do it in a non-committal way. In terms of finishing off parts, I keep in mind that the farther from the torso the appendage is, the more likely it is to change, so that the hand is likely to be in a much different position in subsequent sittings than the upper arm. Always have a talk with a model. You really need to be interested in people if you're going to be a portrait artist. Having them engaged helps me to see the anatomy of their faces. You want to see them smile a little bit and color come into their cheeks as they talk about things that are important to them. If we both enjoy the process, the result will reflect that. The right music helps to set the mood. I don't want a frozen snapshot to work from, but rather a living, breathing person whose hair changes slightly every time they sit down and whose expression comes to life as they get involved in discussion. That way I can pick and choose what I want to capture, and I can feel like I'm drawing inspiration from life rather than just merely being a glorified photocopier. As I place these little details, I'm redrawing in the process and looking for where the corners of the mouth line up with the eye. I try to underplay the corners of the cheek because emphasizing this area makes us look older, and artists tend to overstate it. It's actually a lot subtler than we think it is. A little bit of daylight here crosses over and hits the warm side of the face at the eye and cheek. When you paint a likeness, it's easy to tell if you're off. If the painting looks a little sad or heavy or droopy, we can all read a face, then it tells you your drawing is off. You might say, I'm just painting what I see, but the fact is that all the tiny bits of paint that are just slightly off are fighting against a likeness. Your instinct knows best. There's a little bit of caricature in every good portrait. This is an alla prima painting, one that's done all at once. It is a remnant of a meeting between two people. It should have some life to it and be an artistic expression. It's a sketch, not a formal likeness. When you see a Rembrandt portrait, you feel like you're in the room with him and his subject because you see evidence of his hand in the paint. You don't wonder if he painted from a photo in his basement. You are there in a different time. It's important to work both eyes at once and both ears, if you can see them. Ears hang lower in older people, and they appear lower also when a head tilts back. I'm trying to modulate my warm light by looking for a cooler pink in the cheek. Pure color will bring it forward. It's harder to see temperature changes in photographs as compared to working from life. So since we are working from life, we should try and get those subtle warm, cool changes. The other thing artists need to be careful about in art done from photographs is color in the darks, especially in bright sunlight. Our eye can adjust outdoors and see color both in the lights and in the darks, but a photograph has to average out the tonal range and makes darks muddy. Whenever I can, I try to reestablish dark accents. Here there is a beautiful dark green which cuts deeper into the plane of the canvas and pops the chin forward in space. Hair is thin and transparent and it lets light through. I add pure saturated warm color to this shadow, which immediately gives a translucency to the quality of the hair above it. Moving around the head, I search for soft edges. The rounder a form, the softer its shadow edge will be. As forms recede, they also get soft. Light often reflects up onto the bottom of the chin. I put pure color here rather than light color. This area is in the shadow and should remain darker than the light areas of the face. I do a lot of portrait commissions. Most people have an idea of how they want to be changed. I think people are more interesting the way they are. Hillary has beautiful gray highlights and I want to keep those. If this was a commission, I knew she wanted to downplay them. I could, but the easier route is to change the lighting or the color scheme and put the emphasis on other areas. Here the gray is an important part of the composition, but I could just as easily make it hardly noticeable. That's where the skill of a portrait artist comes in. It's not just copying dabs of color, but it's making artistic decisions as you go along. It's being able to move the viewer's eye to where you want it to go. Again, using a bigger brush for the hair here because there are broader forms. I try not to finish off the hair too much, or the clothing. I want enough done that I can keep it if it's not as interesting at the next session. I need to have background color blocked in before I can get into nuances of color. Again, that's because color is relative, and color changes based on the effect of the tint that surrounds it. I work quickly with a wide brush and try to work both the hair and the background together at the same time. Oil is a beautiful medium because it blends so softly. Some of the background color will diffuse into the hair. The head will never just be a cutout and separate from its environment. Background color is very important and affects the colors in the shadow and at the halftones. Sometimes artists will change the background after the fact, and you can tell because that color isn't related to the colors of the head. Often you can find the color of the room at the halftone. That's where the light and shadow meet. If I paint a bright red background here, it won't look right because the head is not in that kind of environment. An environmental color affects all the colors. Hair is soft and it needs to be blended into its surroundings. You might say, I see a hard edge to the hair. But if you really compare edges, you'll find that it's usually not as hard as other edges you will find. Edges, like color, are relative. You find your hardest and your softest edge, establish those within the limitations of your medium, and then adjust between. Look for large shapes. The body of hair is in the shape of a big oval, and so the highlights should look like they're on a round surface that faces the light. I get a big synthetic brush that is stiff like a bristle brush, but that has more of a defined edge because I want some brush strokes to remain in the scarf. It's going to be a challenge to get the pure color in the light green vest. I clean out my brush as much as possible, or get a new brush, and then start with the purest color on my palette, and try not to get other colors into it. Remember that every time you add one color to the next, you're going to muddy it. When I have paint covering the canvas, I often take my squirrel watercolor mop and just knock down and soften some of the edges and brush strokes. I'll soften the hair a little, and the shadows, and especially on a woman, soften the flesh tones. And be careful not to lose all the beauty in the strokes, and I'll leave evidence of the brush throughout, and in the clothing. Notice how the skin looks soft next to the active brush and the cloth. I'll soften some of the details, like the edge of the face, as it recedes with a long, soft badger hair brush. These silhouettes look sharper in photographs than they actually are. I consider this a good starting place. Everything can be a little bit off, but I know where I'm going. I've got everything where I want it, more or less. Likeness doesn't have to be perfect, just close. I've established color and composition. I've got some soft passages that I can work on top of, and now I can put my stiffer brushes aside and work on finessing a little. Re-establish the cool light. Bring out the warm lights. soften edges. I'll add some accent notes in the scarf to contrast with the soft, gradual flesh tones, and then let it dry until my next session. With breaks, that's about an hour and a half of work, if you can call it that, and I'll leave it for next week. I like a second session on an oil sketch. Since oil is transparent, it gives me a chance to build up the darks and lights. My painting is dry and I'm ready to start in again. I take a scraper blade and cut off any texture that might interfere with my painting later on. I want to leave some of the brush strokes in the scarf in background because there's a beauty in the process of working by hand and I don't want to mush it up. I like it to be visible. The second thing I often do is oil down areas of the painting that I want to be softer with a lint-free rag. Usually, I'll do this in the hair or shadows. The brush will tend to drag more where I don't put this thin layer of oil, and in those spots it will be easier to build up impasto. Traditionally, thick paint and texture help with a feeling of clarity in the light, and thin, soft, transparent paint helps create the illusion of vagueness in shadow or receding form. With a fine brush, I go around and check my drawing. Now is a good time because I've been away from the painting for a week and I have more objectivity. I work around the canvas, checking details against each other. Style is very personal. It's like personality. It's better when it is natural and unforced. If you like a painting that looks more painterly, use a larger brush than normal all the way through and paint along with the forms like Sargent or Soroya. Overlap all your edges and let the paint flow together. If you aim to create a convincing illusion where you forget that you're looking at artwork, paint across the forms like Vermeer and all the way down to rendering with soft brushes and glazes and attempt to hide the work of the hand. I try to land somewhere in between because I like to use the full range of qualities in this medium. I'll work up the warm side of the face by first establishing the brightest highlight. All the lights need to be close in value to each other and in a separate range from the darks. A common mistake is to make tonal changes in the lights too dark and to make passages in the shadows too light. I'm using a soft sable where I can modulate the opacity and thickness of the paint just by the firmness of my touch. I like a second session on a painting because oil paint is transparent, and working over a dried underlayer allows me to get darker darks, lighter lights, and also to use thin complementary layers on top that will create a visually interesting shimmering effect when you see through. Plus, a painting sometimes gets too wet, and you just have to let it dry or scrape it down before more paint will stick. I should say that I'm looking at the model all the time. If you've ever posed for a group of students, what is surprising is how little they look at the model. We are the eyes of our society. We should be looking intently and studying nature carefully, learning how to see more clearly. I've done whole paintings with one or two brushes and no solvents at all. You can pull unwanted paint out of the brush with just a little bit of oil and a rag. It's nice to have little moments of detail like the tips of the hair here. It wouldn't work well everywhere, but if it's a little bit here or there, it adds interest. You always want to think about colored surfaces reflecting to their surroundings, and here I'm pulling out the color under the neck. Skin is really interesting to paint because it is translucent. We see evidence of the underlayer of veins and the dimples of muscles and joints. Corners of the face are not hard like plastic. Skin is softer in fleshy areas and shines tight over bone or cartilage. Transitions should be soft throughout. Ears and nostrils are lit up with light as it passes through the flesh, and local color throughout the body changes from pale cools to pink. Then, certain parts like lips have their own color, not to mention freckles or areas of tanning. Individual people have their own particular coloring. If you paint a portrait with a few simple blobs of color, we will recognize who that is, in the same way that we can recognize people across the street without our glasses on. Hair can be tricky because you really want to get the large massing right and follow the rules of how light hits form. At the same time, there's so much variety and so many nebulous areas that you have to keep that balance between something that's out of control and masses that follow formal rules. I'll use a long soft brush that will make longer strokes that sit on the surface of the hair. Little details in the eye and nose and lips are so important, and when doing a commission, I spend a lot of time finessing these to get them right. The highlights on the eyes define the front of the eyeball, and the eye socket shadow should follow all the rules of cast shadow and reflected light, with the warms and cools in the proper places. Throughout, a likeness depends so much on these tiny little fractions of an inch. It's like flowing water. I'm playing around with the movement and rhythm of the brush strokes to keep the eye moving around the composition and always using peripheral vision. I love this overall color combination. The secondary colors of violet, green, and orange in the warmth of the face. It's like a musical composition in a minor key. Here the darks will, in contrast, really lighten up the feeling of the head. And then I add more darks in the scarf for balance. Of course, painting is a very personal thing, and what I'm after is peculiar to my own sensibilities. There's no wrong or right about it. As Carl Jung, the psychoanalyst, said, the more personal a work of art, the more universal. I'll go back in with some of the highlights cast from the sharp, warm light. People always say that the expression is in the eyes, but an older artist pointed out to me when I was just a teen that most of the expression is in the mouth. We can lie with our eyes, but we're not able to disguise our mouth as easily. The signature is a visual element and part of the composition. The scarf points to my letters in a harmonious violet, and it becomes an interesting little detail for the eye to enjoy. I have a signature that is based on the natural calligraphic stroke of the brush. Just like anything else in the visual arts, as I paint one letter, I keep my eye on the whole. I make sure it doesn't overpower graphically. I finish up with a little more of accenting darks against lights while thinking about which areas I want to heighten or subdue for the compositional rhythm of the piece. I could keep going on this piece until I get a fully rendered likeness, but I'll quit here and maintain the freshness of this sketch. It is what it is. I hope this film gave you something to think about next time you sit down with a model. And I thank you for watching and for supporting the grand tradition of portrait painting from life. I like a second sesh on an oil. Second sesh? What's a sesh? I like a second sesh. I like a second sesh. Oh yeah, this could be at the end. This would be the best part.